Moving swiftly along to another super exciting industry, our next session is the first discussion of the day where we're getting into some deep diving conversations around big data, IoT in the space of industry. How is industry changing? Again, consumer technology gets a lot of focus because we can all kind of engage that quite easily. But it's so important to see how can these advances and disruptors make a difference in the industrial sector. And that's why I'm really, really excited about the next panel, which is called Pure Industrial Disruption. So I'd like to welcome to the stage, please. We have Federico Flores running this session. And if you guys would like to join me on stage, we have Sergio Alvarez from Carto, Vincent Champagne from General Electric, Jose Miguel from Alto Analytics, and Ricardo Martinez from Ecoeconomico. Thanks, guys. Good to have you guys. Thanks for being here.
Thank you, Liz.
Thank you.
Okay. So thank you very much. Pleasure to be here. Thank you to all of you to stay and to share with me this panel. Well, first of all, congratulations to South Summit team, because this is a great success, and it's amazing to be here so, with so many people, companies, and investors. So, okay, so we'll try to introduce ourselves in this. We are going to speak about digital. Technology is everywhere. Technology is in every sector, every company, and it means a disruption for many business. And we are going to speak about that. So first of all, let me introduce the panelists. Please, could you introduce yourself and your company in a minute to 2 minutes?
Sure. Well, good morning, everybody. I'm Sergio Alvarez. I'm the co-founder and chief product officer of a Spanish, an American company now called Carto. So in Carto, we work with more than 1,200 organizations around the world and more than 200,000 users. And we help them to discover and predict the insights behind their location data. So we believe that as company becomes more digital, location becomes more and more important. So we try to focus on location in order to improve logistics on companies, in order to improve market segmentation, and thousands of different things.
Liz Vincent.
Thanks, Federico. Hi, everybody. Very happy to be there. So I'm Vincent Champin. I'm the general manager of G Digital Europe Foundry. So G, General Electric, is the biggest industrial company in the world. And G Digital is a startup we created inside General Electric and which is dedicated on digital industrial. Digital industrial is using digital to make wind turbines, power plants more efficient. So it's a way to use digital to have greener energy, less polluting plants, lot of stuff which are more in the industrial space, which is less common than the consumer space. I mean, our cheaper product is gas turbine for 50 million, not the kind of stuff you'll buy in everyday life.
Okay, so please, Jose Miguel.
Thank you, my name is Jose Miguel Cansado. I'm general manager in Alto Data Analytics, and what Alto Data Analytics does is we are a big data agency that combines technology and human know-how and expertise to actually drive actionable insights, always focus on solving business issues for our clients.
Okay, Carlo, please.
Thank you, Federico. And my name is Ricardo Martinez Rico. I'm a founding partner and president of a Madrid-based consulting firm, which is Equipo Económico. It means economic team. Obviously, we are in the professional services industry, also, and we have that same digital disruption challenge as other companies have. We also deal with investors, with startups. We help them to develop their business plans. We help them to get their financial resources they need. And we also help incumbents in the sense that they are being so heavily challenged by this disruption that we help them to develop their strategies so as to be able to positively face that challenge. And you know, when you talk about startups, you use that 3F model. You say that startups are being helped by friends, family, and fools, and I do belong to this third F, which means fools. Yeah? I am also investing in startups.
Okay, thank you. So let's start. Well, I'm in charge of IT and innovation in Ferrovial, And we decided several years ago to invest in innovation because we thought that it was an opportunity to be different from our competitors. And there was the digital space there. And we see digital as an opportunity of business, an opportunity to increase our P&L of the different business lines we have. And for us, this is an opportunity to increase also the customer service, our customers. And this explosion of technology means opportunities. And this is the way we are trying to deal with this issue. I would like to know your experience and what you see this digital explosion of technology. Is that an opportunity for business? P&L is a risk? How you see that?
Well, I think that is, data is part of that digitalization process. And at least what we do is we believe that data is like the lifeblood of the companies, of the different teams. So I think it's now a reality, right? I mean, if you don't analyze data and don't work with data as part of that digitalization process, you are completely lost, right? It's the easiest way to get like a competitive advantage against your competitors, of course, but it's also the most optimized way of improving your company, internals of your company. So I do believe that, that is indeed happening, and even more on the data side, I would say. I think it's where the most interesting things are happening right now.
Yeah. Vincent, in GE?
So GE was born on a disruption. I mean, we were created 120 years ago. At that time, we just killed the candle with the electric bulb. And if you look at our story, I mean, we were quite good at succeeding in each technology wave. For example, in the 90s, we started moving from films to digital image and healthcare. We were there. What's changing a lot today is two things. First is the cost of hardware. If you take this chip, it can process 150 operations per second. It's connected wireless, and it can connect it to up to 16 machines. 150 million operations per second, that's 4,000 times more power capacity than Apollo 11, the system that put a man on the moon. And you can have this for $2. What does it mean? It means that any improvement that takes data from a machine, that sends it to the cloud to compare with other machines in the world, that compare with all the machines that have ever existed in the history of humanity, at least the one present on the cloud, and if any calculation that use this and that gets a revenue that is more than €2 with this kind of stuff, you will make money. So that opens a lot of opportunity. The other part is development of data. On healthcare, 20 years ago, the data you had was 5 kilobytes, just the transcript of your discussion with your doctor. Today is 200 gigabytes. That's your genome if you want to put it in a file. And it's a multiplication by 40 million in 20 years. 40 million means that if 20 years ago you had one sheet of paper of information, 40 million this is a stack of paper which is as high as Mont Blanc.
Yeah.
Huge. And it opened a lot of opportunity, and the trick now is finding the needle of value into the haystack of data. And for this, we're recruiting data scientists, developers, designers here in Europe, and we think there are lots of opportunity because it's economically wise, it's a market which is probably twice as big as the consumer internet, and you have much, much less people working this space. So huge opportunities for us, huge opportunities for all the young people that want to work in this sector and all the startups that want to work on digital industry. Mm-hmm.
Samuel,
absolutely, and I think that, as Vincent said, the amount of data that now can be generated, that is generated in the industrial domain and in many domains, because at the end, digitalization has blown everything to bits, right? Now everything is digital. You can have, you have an unprecedented amount of data. So now the challenge, as Vincent said, is to find that needle in the haystack, is to separate the signal from the noise, is how you make sense out of those huge volumes of data. And for us, I think there are three main challenges in this domain that you need to take into consideration. The first one is just to be able to capture all that data, right? To create that data lake where you have that huge amount of data, infinite amount of data. It's in real time, sometimes. It's very varied, and it's unstructured sometimes, and you need to structure that. So that's one challenge. But then there's the second challenge, is what to do with that data. What type of algorithms, what type of mathematics, what type of models are you going to be able to do? And you need some strong capabilities to be able to design models which are descriptive models, prescriptive models, or predictive models, which are the holy grail, let's say. And but then there is a third factor, which I think is even more important, and is the link of data science to business issues. Is okay, you have all this technology, all this data, you have all these capabilities, mathematical things that you do, but how do you link that with a business issue, with a problem that you need to solve? And I think this is the key challenge, right? This is the key challenge, and this is where sometimes people get lost in some of these big projects in big data, sometimes get derailed, right? Because the key thing at the end is to have a business-led approach to this. Right?
Okay. Ricardo?
Yeah, and adding some ideas to these issues which have been developed here, I would say that this big data, this data and digital disruption means huge competition, you know, in the sense that obviously that's good for us consumers, for us being considered as consumers, that's great. We have a very impressive portfolio and of goods and services, new goods and new services which are being delivered, but that means huge competition for these new companies which are beginning to find their path, and obviously for incumbents too, which have to completely change their business model in order to be flexible, so competition and flexibility, to be flexible enough to challenge all these new companies which are able to get a stake in all that business. My view is that that means that competition, that huge competition and that flexibility means that companies have to be very less intensive in using fixed assets, you know? And that's a major change for infrastructure companies, hotels, automotive companies, GE, for example, you know, all these companies which have heavily invested and have huge sunk costs because of that, fixed assets, banks, just imagine banks, they have to completely change that structure to be competitive enough to survive that challenge.
Yes, right, and it's amazing for me to be here because you can see we have a very big company like GE, for a real infrastructure company. We have leading startup companies, very successful. It means a mixture of large, small, medium companies. We're all working in the same thing in the digital space, looking for business. And I think this is key for also large company. In my vision in Ferrovial, we decided 5 years ago to build everything around an open innovation methodology. And that's what, because of we thought there were many talented people in the company, many clever people, but there were even more outside of the company. So we needed these companies, these small companies. And mainly we use them for disruptive innovation, because that's difficult to find that inside a large company. And it's easy to work with the small companies which could discover new ideas, new inventions, new projects. This is our model in Ferrovial, and we use this company not to invest in the company, but to use their technologies, and this is the way we enlarge and we engage these small and medium companies. And this is the way we are going to continue working, because it's going very well. The output is quite good. And I would like to know your impression about that, because I think it's a change of paradigm, how large and small companies are working together. Yeah. What do you think about that?
So well, I think like innovation can be driven by different mechanisms, right? I mean, for example, in Carto, 90% of the code that we produce is open source, and it's open to the community. So any user and any client can download Carto and install in their own servers. So what we believe that we are trying to innovate is on the service that we provide, not only on the technology. Related to that, then, when we talk about big companies, it's very important that we approach them from the same angle. It's like we are providing them services, not only technology. I mean, technology is kind of commoditized right now, right? I mean, hardware is very cheap. is very, I mean, you can do whatever you want with a $2 chip, yeah, almost. We have all very powerful sensors and computers in our pockets. Where the magic happens is on talent, right? It's on how people is using technology for disrupting different sectors. And I think like big corporations approaching to startups or to individuals that are trying to put something is key on this, right? I mean, the intelligence about the business is on the big companies. The most interesting data sources is also in big companies most of the time. And it's very, very important for us to be able to work on case studies and successful stories of how to apply our technology, our service to big companies, right? I think this is, and we are now in Spain as part of Europe, and this is kind of different between United States and Europe. I mean, we are based on New York, and there you can feel a different relationship between big corporations than in Europe, but this is starting to change. You can feel how European big companies are starting to put more effort on collaborating with the startups.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Vincent, you engage small and medium companies in GE?
Oh yeah, I mean, we totally share the view of you mentioned of Ferrovial. And for one key reason, I mean, if you take the economics of industrial, you have the classical model in which you take your plant, put it outside of the city, you take your research engineer, they are close to your plant, security barrier around here, and they only talk to your own engineer. And that's very adapted, for example, if you want to make the best airplane engine, because you have few companies in the world, and you won't have a Nürburgring coming to Lufthansa or Air France and telling them, okay, just scrap your airplane engine, use mine. It won't happen. For the digital, it's very different because it's about finding the needle of value into the haystack of data. And for this, you'll never be smarter than a powerful ecosystem. The game there is very different, it's totally opposite. It's putting yourself at the center of the strongest ecosystem. So you have to partner with companies like you, with suppliers, but also with small companies like the one from Alessandro or Sergio. And two examples of this. So we build a platform which is like a bit like the Windows or the Android of a big industrial IoT, which is called Predix. And in this Predix, you have an app store, meaning that if a small company or even an individual developer develop a very powerful analytic in it, he can just put it on the app store, and maybe tomorrow a company from Hong Kong will buy it, meaning that instantaneously he can go from being a guy alone in his home to someone having a network reaching global markets. And that's really where, I mean, big companies have a reach that usually startups don't have, but in very specific domain, you can have a guy who might be a great engineer from an electrical company that developed his software, or a startup which was specialized on specific analytics, and together we're much more stronger than trying to do everything. Then the key strategic question is knowing where you want to be the best, where you don't think you will be the best, and to play where you have to play. And GE have been quite good at this, with of course some mistakes. And for example, in the development part, we don't want to be a system integrator, so most of the development will be done externally. In the industrial data science, we want the best industrial data scientist from Spain, from Germany, from France, inside GE. And we have the biggest and best pool of industrial data scientists, because we think that's really something that is key and for which you need a very large scope to be the best.
Uh-huh. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I think that in this area of disruptive innovation, it's very clear that large corporations have the biggest problems because they do the biggest things, right? They have the biggest amount of data, they have the biggest amount of business and activity. But on the other side, it's very difficult to be disruptive within a large organization because, of course, there is a lot of status quo to do, and many times the disruption is sometimes cannibalizing your own business, right? So it's very wise to all these approaches that you mentioned of open innovation, of, you know, that the, even when IBM many years ago developed the PC, it was a disruption for them, and they did it with a separate team, totally separated team, right? So it's clear that disruptive innovation is led by the startup ecosystem. The smallest companies have a different approach, have less status quo to protect. Let's say that they can do things from scratch. One, in the big data space, I think one interesting thing is that, as I mentioned before, you have big data projects which can be business-led or IT-led, right? Typically, in the old days of 10 years ago, let's say, this would be IT-led. Let's say you would say, well, it's the IT department, this is an IT thing, right? But nowadays, innovation is going at such a fast pace that IT, they have to deal with all these legacy systems, security, and so on, and that sometimes they're not driving innovation anymore, or they find it difficult, right? And they need to have these external companies to do this with this business-centric approach. Just to give one example, in big data, the typical way you would do a project like that, data mining, data warehouses, this was a system many years ago, right? The way you did this project, you would do a design by committee, you would invite a lot of people, you had one of these big consultants to actually put a specification, a phase, then a development phase, a testing phase, all that to find that after 2 years of development, the thing doesn't work, right? Or it, nobody uses it. Today, that's going at a totally different pace, right? You have agile system, you have design thinking, yeah. You know more design by committee. You actually develop things from scratch, and you take this design thinking approach, and then you develop it as a live system. You no longer have this thing of, I give you the system, I commission it, and then we go to maintenance.
Yeah.
That doesn't work anymore, right? All these things are changing, and all these things are driven very much by smaller companies that can do that. But it's very wise, because the big problems are in large companies. And then you can have this mix of having the smaller companies more agile, faster, applying solutions to large corporations.
So, Ricardo,
thank you, Federico. Yeah, I just wanted to add that what we see is that there are different approaches being made by these huge multinationals or by medium-sized companies, but most of them try to combine an approach of hiring talented people, so as to having these people in their own organizations, but they also want to see what's happening around their companies, you know, and they have to keep an eye on what's happening on all these type of new companies which are so aggressive, so flexible, and so competitive. Sometimes they inclusively decide to buy some of these companies, you know, or to partner, as we also see some huge companies are doing. Buying small companies, buying niche companies, partnering with them, I think these are very appropriate strategies to challenge that. What we also see is some companies, they are so devoted internationally, maybe they don't have a business stake in the US, but they decide to open a small office in Palo Alto or in California, generally said, you know, just to see what's happening there. Yeah, they know they want not, they don't want to be actively involved in business in the US, but obviously they have to see what's happening there. So they just open an office and see what's happening. In case they see something which is very interesting for the business model, they also buy these type of companies. So what they have to do is obviously being very much acting and seeing what's happening in their competitive markets, yeah, and acting strategically.
Yes, sir.
So one thing to add is that something that we cannot forget is that how important is to big companies to empower innovation in small companies as well. Mm. So we work with some of our clients, and they are actually contributing to the open source version of our software by solving their particular problem.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we cannot forget that big companies have a lot of resources, a lot of very good talent already. And being able to capitalize that relationship between small companies and big companies is not a real competition.
Yeah, no.
It's very, very valuable for us as well.
Yeah.
So I feel pretty lucky because some big companies are providing us some very good knowledge, and going back to the technology at the code. Yeah, they put some code out of on the cloud.
I completely agree. I mean, it's an opportunity for both. And for me, the key is to be open, to work together. And talent management maybe is the most critical concern to manage in these coming years. No? And let's speak about the future for that. Well, future in digital, I don't know what does it mean. 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, but anyway, future. Because we have many, many projects in all the companies, big data projects, how we monetize the data we have. We have many data in the airports, in services, in cities. how we make business around that is the issue today. And there are coming new technologies like 5G in 2-3 years. IoT is there. We have sensors everywhere in the infrastructure. So how we connect these sensors, what applications are there. In our case also, machine learning is an issue to be concerned and to be, for me it's not a problem. For me are opportunities we will have in the coming years. In our case, with these emerging technologies, we built an innovation hub, which is trying to lead with these technologies with people experts, working totally open with companies, startups, in order to discover new business for real. This is the key. More P&L for the company. We don't invest money because of digital, because of technology. We want to improve the P&L. This is the target. And I wonder what you think about that, because I am excited about the new situation, the new... how you see that? Do you see the future problem, opportunities? Are you excited with that? How do you see the future?
So I think, I see two very, I mean, so many things, yeah. Right? But two main channels or two main trends on this particular topic. One is big companies becoming platforms instead of service providers.
Yeah.
That I think that is key. We are seeing how is it starting to happen with banks, for example. Even with governments, with yeah. open data and some services. But I still think that big companies they need to become platforms somehow.
Yeah.
I mean, platforms for providing more business for other companies or for providing new services that other companies can use for creating business. That is one trend. So one example is that we at Carto are working on something called Data Observatory. So we try to distribute the data generated by big companies and governments yeah. in a very, very easy way so anybody can have access to it. And the second one is related to what José Miguel was mentioning before, is that this idea of the citizen data scientist, is that business analytics or big data projects cannot be led by technology anymore because that was the past, right? I mean, now it's about actionable insights. And for that, we need to create a new set of tools that allows non-data scientists to do analysis or to take decisions and to put the control of data on the business units within corporations. So that those are the, we don't have so much time, but those are the main trends that I will say.
So platforms, Vincent, predicts, and what do you say about that?
Yeah.
The future, I mean.
Future, maybe three main things. First, development of connected devices. So next year, you'll have more connected devices in the world than you have humans, so 8 billion. That will keep increasing. Second, what you can do with software. So in the 70s, when $1,000, you could buy the equivalent of the intelligence of a bacteria. Today, you can buy the equivalent, the intelligence of a monkey. In 2030, you'll be able to buy the equivalent, the intelligence of a human for $1,000. And it will change a lot of things, much more than we imagine. So it can have some consequences on job and on the place of human in society, but we think that if we handle it correctly, it just put people in a new domain, not necessarily making less job, but different job. For example, if you take a radiologist today, it's a guy looking at a radio. In the future, it will be your personal data scientist. He will have the image, he will have sensor on your temperature or anything about you, and he will be able to make a much better diagnostic. And the third thing, maybe, it's about talent. And in this, I'm not totally agree that big companies have less an advantage. I mean, usually small companies have the speed, big companies have the mass, and energy is mass multiplied by speed to the square. Yeah. And on some domain, critical mass is very, very important. If you want to make data centers, there's no way you can be competitive and small, no way. If you want to make industrial data science, it's like building a football team. So if we were to build a football team just with people sitting here, it would be, I'm not sure it would be the best player, it would be an okay yes. team. If you take them in this room, it would be a better team. If we take the people in Madrid, of course, it would be a great team. If we take them globally, you can take the best player in Brazil, the best player in Madrid, maybe one player in Paris, not no. Then you'll have a team which is absolutely imbeatable. And so on this, I really think there is an advantage, and we'll see a globalization of talents. On some domain, really critical mass, which is, which only big companies can reach, and also lots of very powerful niche, which much more application of software, because you'll have much more ways to make this profitable, which a lot of space for small companies.
Okay, thank you. So Miguel.
Yeah, I think that trying to predict something about the future is quite challenging.
Yeah.
And I think that the only thing that for sure we can predict is that change, there will be a lot of change.
Yes.
Change is the only constant, let's say. I think we're going to have, for sure, more and more data. I mean, that's something that we can also predict. Amount of data will be growing. And probably I still think that one of the key challenges will remain to actually separate the signal from the noise, to actually see how you can make use out of the of that data, because we will have many more. And even now today, I think that the amount of data that companies have is unexploited. Let's say, I think that they all exploit a very little amount of data. Just to give an example, there's so much external data outside of companies that can be used that sometimes they're not using it. And you can get the opinion of your client, of your customers, what they are saying in social media as one of your inputs for your development, for your product development. Let's say you can have so many type of different insights already from that you're not getting. In the future, there will be many more sources of data, many more opportunities, and still the challenge, I think, will be to actually separate that signal from the noise, to be able to link that amount of data, the technology available to actually make sense out of that.
Okay.
Some two additional ideas to these issues which have been mentioned here. First one, I see a major challenge in the regulatory issues. You know, in a survey which has been developed by GE after the event you organized in Paris, Vincent, GE has partnered with a digital media, which is politico.com, a very influential one. And they have organized a survey just to ask people, and I've been asked to, what the major challenge will be. Yeah? And the issue related to fintech, which was the first sector which has been analyzed by your survey, is regulatory issues. How to manage that trade-off between competition, confidence, incumbents, and startups. Yeah, how to manage all that issue? Incumbents being challenged by the national banks to raise capital, while they are being challenged by incumbents in their most profitable business units. You know, and how to do that? So regulatory issues, and second issue, education. You know, and this is something you have in a way mentioned. You know, how to organize the match between all these needs the industry has to develop all these new products, all these digital economy, how to match that with the education we and our kids and our children are getting so as to be, let's say, employable, yeah, in the sense that you need all these people to have the talent, to have the skills, so as to be able to match all these labor needs the industry will have. And just to finish and to share it with the audience, we are so committed to that issue that next week we are bringing here to Madrid, to the foundation you know very well, Federico, to the Rafael Foundation. We have partnered with the Harvard Business School, and we will have here Sunil Gupta, one of the best professors analyzing and studying strategies, developing digital disruption. And you know, the speech he will deliver next week, as I've said here in Madrid, is leading in a digital disruption age. You know, that's the issue we are so dealing with.
We are invited.
Obviously, that's why I'm saying it here.
Okay.
Obviously. But that's
okay.
Something which means how committed here in Spain we are also with that
thank
issue.
You. So, amazing future, changing environment, large and small companies working together, open environment.
many talented management issues, many people around this business, many opportunities for new business, a lot of data around the business, a lot of sensors, a lot of hardware, software. So it's an amazing future and changing environment that means opportunities for big companies and medium companies and small companies. I think you have two options, to adapt your company in order to look for new business or maybe to disappear, I don't know when, but in several years. But it's a new environment, you have to adapt to that. So South Summit, thank you very much to all the speakers in this panel. I think it was a great panel, for me very interesting, and thank you very much for sharing with me this table, and of course, thank you to the audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.